We're happy to have Coach Avery Johnson inside the locker room. Good morning, Coach. How are you?
Morning.
Good morning, Wimp and Bear. How are you guys doing today?
Good. How you doing?
We're good. Hey, Avery, if you see Jim Farmer walking around, would you get my check from him? He came, stayed at my house last week, brought his son to my camp, and never paid. So if you could grab that check, I'll swing by your house and pick that up if you see him today. Yeah.
Good luck.
Do that, Baron. I told him you were in my neighborhood, didn't stop by and say hello. And he blamed it on you. He said, Barry said, you're never home. I said, you're right, I'm never home. I'm trying to get Alabama basketball to the next level. So it's 14-hour days in the office. It's not like those NBA guys like Jim Farmer. You know, they only work an hour a day.
Yeah,
you know, Barry.
I gotcha. Dad, go ahead.
Big night for you, not only for the program, but I guess for Colin as well, a combination of both. Give our listeners an overview of sort of what happened and what you thought might happen and a little bit about it.
Well, Colin, as the season evolved, started rising up the mock drafts board.
And all right, Coach, got you back. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Sorry about that. But because of all of the feedback I was getting from all of the NBA folks, we got some indications that, you know, one, he needed to go early and be a one and done, but also that he was going to be a top 10 pick. You know, with our NBA pro day where we had 58 scouts, we had 200 scouts in attendance at our games. We had two owners in attendance when we played Oklahoma, one Dan Gilbert from Cleveland, and two, Tony Ressler from the Atlanta Hawks. So they had a chance to see Trae Young and Colin Sexton play against each other, and that's why we wanted to schedule those games, and I'm glad we were a part of the SEC Big 12 Challenge. But the indications were that he was going to go in the top 10. We were really excited for the family. He was excited. And for him to go to Cleveland and have the opportunity to play with LeBron James, I just think it's outstanding.
Yeah, we're just hoping that LeBron will come back. I think that would be great for Colin. I think Colin would be good for LeBron as well. What do you think the chances of that, Coach, of LeBron going back to Cleveland and getting to play alongside Colin Sexton?
Well, anything is possible. I know there are teams like the Lakers that are lining up, you know, with Magic Johnson, and they want to make a pitch, and the Houston Rockets would love to have him. The Celtics, the Philadelphia 76ers, there are a lot of teams that would love to have him that think they're close, or that want to make a big move in terms of the Lakers by bringing in LeBron and some other max player. But I'm really optimistic about him staying in Cleveland. You know, when he was leaving the floor in his last game at Cleveland, it's not like he waved to the crowd like it was a swan song. He has two sons, and he really loves his family. He never gets enough credit about being a really good father and husband. You know, people like sometimes focus on, yeah, he loves to cry for fouls sometimes. And a lot of NBA players like to do that, and coaches. But I'm optimistic about him staying in Cleveland, and hopefully, not that Colin is Kyrie Irving, but Colin is a terrific offensive player, and I think he's going to be even better in the NBA. More space, he's fast with the ball, he can get a shot off against anybody. So I'm hoping the addition of Colin, and with them drafting Colin, that would give LeBron a little bit more pause to think about returning, because I don't know if he's going to find a better team that can come as close to they did against Golden State in game one. You make a free throw or you call a timeout and you execute better at the end of game one. Maybe you win game one, maybe you win game three. So hopefully he'll stay in Cleveland. Yeah.
Nobody's better to answer this question than you are. And you've already alluded to it a little bit. I don't know in visiting with you that everything that Pop told you was the way you wanted to do it. You can comment on that if you want to, but my question is, how difficult is it for a young guy to come and play in the backcourt, whether he's two guard, point guard, whatever? How difficult is that to do you know, for people to expect too much. And I know he's got great ability in the space. He'll be much better. How difficult is that, and how much he has to learn to really be effective?
Well, it took me, several years to really learn it because, I was coming from a different situation, played at a smaller school. I wasn't drafted. I think with Colin, a lot of the, guys that he's going to play against, quite a few of them, they've been on the circuit, the AAU circuit for years, with all of the summer ball and where, guys can get around the different leagues. He's played against a lot of these NBA players in summer league situations and workouts. You get invited to the Chris Paul camps, and after the camps are over with, the Chris Pauls and the LeBron James and the Paul Georges and all those guys, they're playing ball after those camps. So I don't think Colin's going to be nearly as starstruck playing against those guys. I think, his experiences here at Alabama, we tried to, somewhat train him because we know what they're looking for in terms of the way we played and situations where I maybe gave him a little bit more rope to express himself on the court. But I think he'll be ready. I don't think it's necessarily expecting too much. Sure, there's going to be a little bit of a transition period. The game's a little bit more physical and guys are bigger and stronger. He's playing against Chris Paul and Westbrook and Steph Curry and a lot of those guys on a nighty and night out basis. But I will tell you this, he will not be afraid and he will have a high level of confidence. Even if he fails, that failure will not stop him from trying again and, him working on his game and getting ready for the next game.
Yeah, good.
Coach, I know you got your camp going on now, and I always talk about, hey, players are made in the summer, teams are, made during the season. You guys you've done a great job of kind of welcoming back former players, guys that played for you, but even guys from other eras, and that doesn't happen everywhere. I guess this is two questions. One, talk about kind of these guys coming back, and then two, maybe about some of your guys and how much they're improving this summer.
It's great, Barry. 3 years ago, man, I just felt like there were just 50 different things I had to tackle, and I just tried to address each one minute at a time. And one of the things I felt was there was a disconnect with our former players. And that's why we strategically wanted to get guys like Jim Farmer and Derek McKee and Mo Williams. And I ran into Antonio McDice about a month ago in the airport. He's coming back. Keith Askins, Robert Horry. And not because I'm on your show, but I felt really strongly about connecting, with your dad and Coach Wimp. I just felt it just was a natural thing for me. And I talked about that with my old college coach, Ben Joe, before he passed away, who Coach Wimp knew. But I just think it's important to honor all of the guys from the past that have meant so much to our program, that have led our program to the second most wins in the SEC behind Kentucky. And I just think it's critically important that our players can see successful coaches like Coach Wimp, Coach CM before he passed away, successful players that have came to Alabama and that have gone to the NBA. And that was a great role model for guys like Colin Sexton. So that should answer your first question. Second part, the offseason is really important for us. Our assistant coaches take on a huge, huge, huge role, especially in the summertime. Because we have to develop our players. If they need to dribble a little bit better with their left hand, if they need to become a better three-point shooter, some of our big guys, got to become better offensive rebounders. We got to understand spacing better. We need our shooters to not only shoot, but we need them to be makers. So people are always talking about when you're recruiting players now that he's a shooter. Mm-hmm. I told my coaches, I don't need shooters, I need makers. Our plays are going to work a lot better. So the offseason is important. Some of our kids need to get a little stronger. Some need to lose weight. Some need to gain weight. But it's a big part of our program is our offseason training program because the season doesn't start when the season starts. It actually starts right after Memorial Day for us when our players report to the first summer session.
Are the new kids here? Can you tell us a little bit about each one of the new guys that maybe the fans don't know about?
Yeah, the new kids are all here. Jared Butler, our point guard that we recruited and signed out of Louisiana. Javian Fleming, the big forward out of Mississippi. And Deontay Wood from Anniston. They're all here. Along with Riley Norris is back healthy again. He's playing well. We need to add some experience. We were the fourth youngest team in the country last year. So adding Riley Norris, not just, you know, because he can make a shot. We need his rebounding. We need his toughness and his experience. We're going to rely on Tevin Mack a little bit more for some shot making, kind of like what you saw with those Villanova guys. I talked to Jay Wright at the draft, and it was, hey, from a talent standpoint, you guys are close. You just got to make some more shots, and hopefully Tevin Mack can help us in that area. And guys like John Petty, you know, he'll shoot it well at home and on the road because he's a little bit more experienced. He's a little bit stronger, and Herb Jones is going to get better. And so I'm excited about where we're going. And we had always talked about year three and beyond, and now we're going into year four, and we hope to take that next step.
Yep. I appreciate our relationship. You've been awfully nice to me, and I appreciate it. I don't know that you can answer this, but I don't even know that you want to, and you can say you don't want to. A little bit of any thoughts at all publicly that you can give on the arena. And I guess number two, any thoughts at all that you can give on the non-conference schedule?
Okay, yeah, great. I'll start with the non-conference schedule first. You know, part of the non-conference schedule, even though we haven't released it yet, based on what we did last year, you know, it's obvious to a lot of fans out there, you know, who's going to be on our non-conference schedule. We obviously, you know, played at Arizona last year, so we'll have a return game with them in Tuscaloosa this year. We have to travel to Central Florida because we played them at home, and we have a return game at Central Florida this year. So we'll be a part of the SEC Big 12 Challenge again, which I lobbied for in my first year, and that's been released to the public that we'll be going to Baylor. And then we'll announce here in the next couple of weeks the rest of our non-conference schedule, but it's going to be just as good as it was last year. You know, if we don't have that schedule, if we don't go out and challenge ourselves, you know, we don't make it to the tournament last year, but we challenged ourselves, and that was very strategic. And we have a lot of folks that came to me, my coaches, Colton Houston, our director of basketball ops. We all kind of put our heads together, hired some folks from New York and looked at it, and it all worked out. In terms of the arena, Coleman Coliseum, you know, when I first arrived, there weren't any necessary promises that were made, but, you know, when I first arrived 3 years ago, you know, we talked about that's something that they're going to need to look at because the Coliseum is going to be embarking on its 50-year anniversary. And, you know, are we going to build a new one? Are we going to renovate Coleman? And when Greg Byrne was hired here, a task that he took on, and I've been in all of the meetings, and I think it's going well. I think something's going to happen at the appropriate time. Greg's going to announce it. But, you know, and if it is a newly renovated Coleman Coliseum, you know, folks will not recognize the inside of it because I have an idea of what it would look like. So, you know, I'm not going to overstep Greg. He'll announce it at the appropriate time, but something's going to happen. I'm really excited about what that's going to be because it's going to, again, help our program take that next step in terms of having the right seating capacity, clubs, amenities, fan interaction, taking care of our students, which I think is critical to the vibrancy of our program.
Coach, I wanted to ask you, football put in a new rule, which I think is good, where you could play a guy four games and he could still redshirt. Are the basketball coaches looking at that, maybe lobbying for, hey, let us play a guy six or seven games, kind of see if he's ready, and then he could still redshirt. Is that on the table at all for basketball?
You know, I haven't heard that, Barry. I've been in, you know, at SEC meetings. That didn't come up in our meetings, but I'm sure without all these different ad hoc committees and our basketball coaches association, they'll look at it. I think it would be an interesting concept, especially if you know, 7 or 8 games. Great.
Yeah.
I would sign up for it.
Yeah, no doubt. Well, Coach, we appreciate it. How's camp going?
Camp's going good. Today is the last day of camp. You know it. You have a great camp. I've heard about it. You know, the kids have done a great job. It gives our parents, our campers, another chance to come on campus, check out all of our wonderful facilities, not just around in and around the sports, but also the academic part of it. I get a chance to work with our former players, current players, our coaching staff. It's just great. But today is our last day. But I wanted to ask one quick question before I go, before you run out of time.
All right.
Did I hear Steve Spurrier coaching some Alliance football team?
Yeah.
Yeah. Orlando.
Well, okay. I was just wondering if a G League team comes to Birmingham, Wimp, or, you know, and they want to hire you to coach, or are you going to sign up? I was just wondering. Yeah. About
well,
that.
let me say this. Are you ready?
Because I can't
this
lose you on the road this year. Yeah. I need you.
Are you ready? Are you ready for this one?
Steve
Spurrier is going to coach 10 games and get $500,000.
I guarantee you, Coach, if they pay him
that himself, he got $500,000. He told me standing in the Birmingham Country Club, he was going to get $500,000 for 10 games.
Wow.
If they pay him that, he'd coach 10 seasons, Coach.
All right. Well, I can't lose my role partner now. We love having Whippers.
I'm not coaching your team or anybody else's team. My coaching days are over.
Coach, he was at the SEC tournament. Y'all didn't win the tournament. He lost his last game on the road. So don't brag on him too much. You're only as good as your last game.
I put that play in where Sexton caught that ball and went down there in 4.1 seconds. And scored. I put that play in just in the last minute.
We talked about that the night before, remember?
Yeah. I love that.
I can't do every game.
That's like when Steph Curry hits all those shots and Steve Kerr looks over at his assistant and says, man, that is some great coaching right there, isn't
it? Yeah. Well, we just better make sure, Barry, when he comes, we get his chicken right in the team room. Okay, we got to make sure we get his chicken cooked right.
And guard your plate, because he'll walk around and eat off of everybody's plate but then say he didn't have a meal.
All right. All right. Guys, thanks for having me on.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Coach.
Roll Tide.